Yay.
Let us rise for the gospel acclamation. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. The Holy Gospel according to John chapter 9, verses 1 through 41. Glory to you, O God. As Jesus walked along, he saw a blind man from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes. Then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that he now sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind. And they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and then he found him, and he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshiped him. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
you may be seated. Grace and peace to you this Lord's Day. We are right in the middle of Lent, and it is therefore appropriate that we have a well-crafted story today from the Gospel of John about sin. Well, it doesn't begin as a story about sin. It begins as a story about an unfortunate man who has been blind from birth. We learn that he is poor and a beggar and without much hope. He's the poorest of the poor and unable to provide for himself. In that time and in that place, there was not much mercy or help given to people in his situation. Jesus sees the blind man, and Jesus' disciples also see the blind man and immediately launch into a theological discussion with, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Do you understand the line of reasoning the disciples are making here? The disciples are making a connection between the man's blindness and sin. The disciples are making this connection with someone who is in tragedy, someone in a disabled state. There must be something he or his parents did to deserve such tragedy. I remember a story from way back in 2005 when Hurricane Katrina devastated the Gulf Coast, causing enormous destruction and significant loss of life. It was the costliest hurricane to ever hit the United States. And a lawmaker in Alabama said at the time that the hurricane hit where it hit because Mississippi and Louisiana had legalized gambling. That's right. God sent the hurricane to punish those states for their sin. You see, in this line of thought, we've got to explain sadness and tragedy, and sin becomes a rationale. If God is good and righteous, then if there is bad occurring, then the bad must be punishment for our unrighteousness. Well, upon hearing the lawmaker's theory of divine punishment, a minister responded, well, if the Lord was aiming for those casinos, then the Lord needs to improve his aim. The hurricane took out about 8 casinos, but nearly 100 churches were also destroyed. Note that Jesus will have no part in this simplistic and just plain bad theology of attempting to establish a direct correlation between sin and a person's circumstances in life, over which this man had no control. Neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus. And with that, Jesus spits, makes a paste of mud, and heals the man's blindness. Now, if you think that everyone in town was thrilled by the news that the blind man had been healed, think again. First, the man's neighbors question the man's healing as a case of mistaken identity. The people who had passed by the poor man every day now don't seem to recognize him. A debate ensues. This can't be the same man who was blind, they reason. So they haul the once blind man to the religious officials, the custodians of moral and theological respectability. They want a ruling or an interpretation on the matter. When the once blind man is presented to them, the religious authorities, the people in charge of spiritual things, the keepers of theological correctness, that is, people like me, immediately focus on Jesus as a sinner who fails to keep the Sabbath by performing healing work on that day. Some of the Pharisees are thrown into a state of bewilderment and confusion as to how a sinner can perform such miraculous healing work. When the once blind man is called to offer testimony in the debate, he responds that he doesn't know a great deal about sin. All he knows is that he was once blind and now he can see. Next up are the parents of the blind man. Because of their fear over what could happen to them, they defer to their son. Ask him, he is of age. Again, the once blind man says, I've told you already. And getting a bit testy, he says, would you like to become his disciples? At this, Jesus' critics become enraged and say to the man that he was born entirely in sin and therefore has no business teaching anybody about anything, and so they drive him away. It's all sad. Here's a man who has been healed of lifelong blindness, but no one celebrates the healing. Not even the man's parents. John narrates for us a rather long gospel story this morning, 41 verses to be exact. And what consumes most of the space is this carping back and forth argument that arises after the astoundingly wondrous healing. I know lots of people who consider themselves to be open-minded, tolerant, curious, factual, following the evidence, no matter where it leads. But sometimes, if the facts or the evidence challenge their worldview, or it doesn't fit their preconceptions of what can and what can't be, they simply reject it. It's like we have this set of little boxes, each one a cause that explains why something happened. When something happens, we rush to file it away in one of these boxes. This caused that, or that caused this, and so forth. Now, it is of the nature of a miracle to be an intrusion, something not expected and not easily explained. Rather than say, "Wow, that is interesting," in the face of a miraculous claim, we are conditioned to say, "Well, now let's get all the experts together and explain what happened using all of our acceptable modes of explanation." Here was a man who was once blind, now he sees, and no one takes the time to wonder, to give thanks, to celebrate with him. The whole thing is turned into an intellectual problem to be solved. Let's all get our heads together now and explain this in such and such a way that we can reassure ourselves that nothing new has happened here that doesn't fit our preconceived ways of explanation. Because if something truly new has happened, and if it happened by the hand of Jesus, then we might have to go back to the drawing board and rethink our cherished assumptions, like, if you are blind, you must have sinned. The amazing thing here is that Jesus, also a rabbi, also a religious leader, refuses to enter into the debate. He refuses to label anybody as a sinner. He saves his harshest comments for the Pharisees, those religious leaders who are here so obsessed with the order of things, with right and wrong, with sin and righteousness, that they display no compassion for the poor and his parents, and show no joy at the man's healing and restoration. In a way, it is a story full of irony with those who think that they can see so clearly who is and who isn't a sinner, shown to be those who are actually the blind ones. In the end, it is the once blind man who now truly sees who Jesus really is, someone more interested in healing, compassion, and salvation than into condemnation. So I'm hoping that some of you here this morning may find comfort in the role played by the formerly blind man. There is a kind of quiet dignity about him. He just simply testifies to what he knows and sees. "Here's what I know," he says. "I once was blind, now I can see." And who are we to doubt him? I find myself wanting to cheer this formerly blind man on. If he were here today, I would say, go ahead, go for it. Stick with your experience of God, of how God has touched your life. Ignore the narrow-mindedness of the world. Just celebrate your healing, give gratitude to God, and don't try to overanalyze it. The story ends with Jesus pronouncing the religious authorities, the ones who were so intent on rooting out sin, to be the ones whose sin remains. Let us beware, lest we follow them and do what they do. It is so easy to play God and self-righteously point to the sin in other people. To sit around having conversations about who sinned and who didn't sin, than to see the sin in ourselves. So maybe our time during this Lenten season may well be best spent not theorizing about sin, but not trying zealously to root out the sins of others, but rather in humbly confessing our own sin. And let us not forget to celebrate a God who comes to us in love despite our sin. Amen. Thank you. Let us confess our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, Father, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. Came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. The third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who was with the Father and the Son, is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and for all creation. Eternal God, you seal us by the Holy Spirit and mark us with the cross of Christ forever in baptism. Inspire us by your love as together we strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Creating God, by your word you have made all things, and you hate nothing that you have made. Teach us to perceive the beauty of the breath of your creation, from the grandest mountain range to the smallest springtime bud. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Powerful God, you anoint kings and establish rulers. Guide the work of the heads of state and elected officials. Encourage them to lead with justice and to remove barriers that impede the well-being of all. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Shepherding God, you lead us beside still waters and restore our souls. Keep watch over those who weep, tend all those who are sick, and comfort all who grieve. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God, our host, you fill us at your table with more than we could ever ask. Feed us with hunger for justice. Equip the feeding ministries of this congregation and community. Nourish us so that we may nourish our neighbors. Merciful God, receive our prayer. God of history, with thanksgiving we remember our ancestors in faith who cared for your people. We praise you for the ways that they formed the faith of others and continue to inspire us. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of all nations, we lift before you the people of the Ukraine. We ask your power at work for those whose lives are being torn apart, both those under assault and those being forced into violence beyond their nature. Guide the leaders of all nations that wisdom and compassion may reign. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
God of healing, we lift before you particular situations or people aloud, silently, or by chat. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation. Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please share Christian greetings with those around you.
Peace of the Lord, everyone.
Peace of the Lord, Eric and
peace,
Stephen.
Bonnie.
Hi, everybody. Hokinson.
Peace, Art and Steve and everyone.
Everyone. Hokinson and Crystal, blessings to you.
Let us continue with our offering.
God of good gifts, receive these and all our offerings as we present them in faithful service for the sake of your gospel. Prepare our hearts to receive you in this meal as you pour out your very presence through Christ Jesus, the wellspring of eternal life.
Amen.
Let us rise if you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food. The body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. And receive Jesus, our strength in the wilderness.
Thank you.
course, Jeffrey.
Jesus Christ, body given for you. Christ, blood shed for you.
Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Embodied God, at your table, we have tasted the goodness of Jesus. With the eyes of our hearts open to your promise, empower us to hear the needs of our neighbors and to touch the world with your love.
Amen. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen.
Peace, to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Mm-hmm.